compliance with Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, entitled Open Public Meetings Act. Adequate notice of this meeting has been provided as specified in the Act. Proper notice of this meeting was posted on October 8, 2009. Said notice was also posted at the entrance of the Board of Education offices, mailed to the Nutley Sun, the Star Ledger, North Jersey Herald News, and the Nutley Journal, mailed to the Nutley Township Clerk. This is an official meeting. Formal action will be taken. Please rise for the flag salute and a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This is conclusive. Call the roll. Here. Here.
Mr. Musgrove.
Here.
Mr. Riley.
Here.
Mr. Rogers.
Here.
Mrs. Russo.
Here.
Mr. Sauter.
Here.
Mr. Spazzato. Dr. Passell.
Here. I have a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Second, Mr. Francolin. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Passed unanimously. Any correspondence? No correspondence at this time. Okay, so move right along to reports. We have an academic report from Mrs. Clarko tonight. We know you'd like to stay for the whole meeting, but I suggest you give your report first and then we get to it.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're very welcome. And by way of introduction, as everyone knows, particularly our educators in the audience, we have had a very ambitious curriculum revision from pre-K right through to high school, and Mrs. Clarko and Mr. Klitsch are heading this up. And we do want periodic reports to keep the public and the board informed. So first, I'd like to thank Mrs. Clarko and Mr. Klitsch for their hard work on this. And thank you for being here on this very, very hectic week to give you the report. Thank you.
Okay, first of all, I would like to just give an overview of articulation day that we just recently had for curriculum revision. Once again, everyone has been working very diligently. I can't say enough about our staff, the professionalism that they're showing as far as meeting even on their own time, getting things done, organized. We are keeping in mind the horizontal and vertical alignment of the curriculum, so we really are making headway. In fact, I have good news. Either next month, in February or March, we'll be starting to do our presentations of the different curricula areas. So we're really moving along. Just to give you a brief report on the status of our 2008-2009 state testing results, I'd like to start by just giving you an overview. Currently, the statewide assessments for elementary and middle school grades are administered as the New Jersey Assessment of Skills and Knowledge, which we all know as New Jersey ASK. They replaced ESPA and GEPA and are administered annually in language arts literacy and mathematics in grades 3 through 8 and in science in grades 4 and 8. In 2008, the State Board of Education established higher levels of expectation for student achievement on the New Jersey ASK for grades 5 through 8. Students now have to earn at least 50% of the possible points on the test in order to be deemed proficient in language arts literacy and mathematics. Previously, at most grade levels, they could be deemed proficient having earned less than 50% of the possible points. The establishment of higher standards also occurred in third and fourth grades, and that happened this year. Higher standards in the earlier grades will ensure that students that enter ninth grade will be better prepared for the demands of high school, post-secondary education, and careers. Now, the scoring bands that the New Jersey ASK uses would be first advanced, a score of 250 to 300, proficient 200 to 249, partially proficient 100 to 199. The scores of students who are included in the partially proficient level are considered to be below the state minimum level of proficiency. These students may need additional instructional support, basically our math and reading strategies program. Now to get to our scoring results. In reviewing the test results, Nutley students tend to achieve at or above the DFG district factor group. This is a comparison of schools that have a similar socioeconomic status and achieve at or above statewide criteria in most areas. For the school year 2008-2009, all Nutley Elementary Schools and John H. Walker Middle School attained AYP status. Annual yearly progress. Although the results of the general population of Nutley High School were quite outstanding, with 96% of the students passing HESPA, Nutley High School did not make AYP for one indicator, which was our students with disabilities. After careful analysis of the results of the HESPA for 2008-2009, Mr. Catrabone, Mr. Palazzola, Mrs. Francioso have implemented the following recommendations. The creation of inclusion classes on every level gives the students the benefit of classroom instruction by a regular English certified teacher assisted by a certified special education teacher that gives in-class support each day during the classroom instruction. And the special education teacher then also has a self-contained class that they're taking. So this is more continuity in our curriculum, and that's what we're trying to tighten up. English and basic skills classes are being exposed to open-ended questions using evidence from the text as well as inferential and critical thinking skills. They're also putting a HESPA prep course in, similar to the SAT prep courses, which will be given during zero period and will be attended by those students who were chosen by Mr. Williams and Mr. D'Ambola based on last year's New Jersey Pass. Now, we use New Jersey Pass in grades 1 and 2, and they also use New Jersey Pass at the high school level. So that's what they're looking at as an indicator to see what students would need this special course to help them along to meet the rigorous standards now attached to HESPA. So this class will meet from January 19 through March 1st. There continues to be an ongoing dialogue between all disciplines, especially with the special ed department and regular ed department at all levels, to ensure continuity of instruction in preparation for the test, which will be administered in the spring. Actually, our school district did an outstanding job. I'm very proud to say that. We do have this one area. Again, it was in the area of students with disability, but we've already put a plan, we have goals, and I'm sure we'll work on reaching those goals. Any questions?
Any questions?
Yeah. I have a question, Ms. Clerico. Two questions, actually. My first one is in regard to horizontal and vertical articulation. Where are we in context with where we want to go?
Okay. All the disciplines are meeting at Nutley High School, which that helps us in the reason why we chose certain classrooms was for the logistics, so we can communicate with the different disciplines. We're really having it from first grade to fourth, and then our fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth are meeting together, which that's something that we've never done before. We're taking the elementary grades, even though they're five and six. It's really a middle school setup, so we're addressing all the standards, across the curriculum.
And as far as special ed with the inclusion and self-contained classes you referred to, and trying to bring that component up, so hopefully we don't lose that again. Right. How do you see that? What's your timeline for that?
Okay, we really are, I think, right where we should be. We've always had dialogue going on between special services, the special ed department, and regular ed department, but even more so now. Especially in the teachers involved with the special needs students, where we have to present the curriculum to all students. And that's why we don't have a special ed curriculum. That's why the need for inclusion for our students to meet these standards, we have to be accountable. And that's what our teachers are continuing to plan together. They have common planning time. Mr. Catrabone has tried to do that so that the inclusion teachers as well as the regular teachers are meeting together to ensure their success.
And I know you mentioned Mr. Catrabone and Mr. Colicchio and Mrs. Francioso
right.
in in the group that meets. Are the department chairs part of those meetings as well?
Two of the department chairs sent me their progress on AYP, actually this week. So yeah, only when we meet, and I should go back a bit for curriculum revision, every month prior to the facilitators and the staff meeting, I meet and Mr. Coliccio meets with all the coordinators. So we've been having ongoing dialogue. I've had updates sent to me regularly. They're giving me samples of the curriculum so that I can see if there's any adjustments that have to be made. We are tweaking different things, multidisciplinary connections, so forth. We're asking Chris Osija to take a look at the technology component. So again, and we're trying to move our students into the 21st century. When I say that, I know I said it the last time I met with you, December 9th, about the digital learner. We're trying to keep all this in mind. And believe it or not, it's all coming together. I believe it was Health that's completed their curriculum. We're almost finished with the mapping. And that's another thing that ensures continuity and the alignment to mapping. So yeah, we're right where we should be.
And I have a question for the superintendent as well, because one of the concerns, I believe, with the special ed component, even though you've articulated the point that there's no special ed curriculum, but one of the issues I thought were that the special ed staff really didn't have enough communication with the principals. Has that changed? I mean, has that setup changed, or do they still report only to the director of special education, or how is that synchronized for the
year? My special ed department, I shouldn't say mine, Spring Garden School's special ed department, now I observe them, I evaluate them, I meet with them frequently. In fact, I'm in classrooms today. So I know all the elementary principals are doing that, and I know Mr. Coliccio has done that prior to us, for the rest of the elementary principals, observing and evaluating. So yes, we are very directly involved with our special education staff.
And that's just my question.
And if I can, I think
one time there was a disconnect.
Right. I think there is a philosophical divide. Regular ed, special ed, and we've worked very hard. All of our elementary principals, our coordinators, our middle school, high school principal, to remove that. What we were doing is unifying the curriculum, but differentiating the instruction. So the curriculum is the curriculum. The content area, what we expect students to master, remains constant throughout. But it's the differentiated instruction that delivers that curriculum in a way that's most beneficial to those students.
Sure.
We have, again, I remember going back 5 years, we discussed this, and we're really making, I think, not inroads or progress, but I think we're almost to the point where we're completing that task.
Sure.
I also think with the district's philosophy with inclusion, we do a great deal of inclusion. And I think that's what's helping us meet bridge the gap.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Mr. President.
Yes, sir.
Any comment on that? The last report that Mrs. Clerico provided this school board, I had asked her through the superintendent that she provide me with a summary of what she presented to this board. And she did it in a timely manner. And I took that summary and I published it in this monthly update that I send the PTOs and taxpayers and parents throughout the district. I received about 42 responses from citizens who were very, very pleased with getting this information. And I learned something through this evolution here. The people want answers to questions. They want to know what direction we're going in. They want to know if it's going to be worth their investment to send their children to the school district, not only in 2010, but years thereafter. And Mrs. Clerico, through your summaries and reports, you provided those answers. So I would ask that we continue to move in this direction. It's a positive direction, it's a good direction. And I just want to commend you for the job that you've done with your staff. That's another thing. Let's talk about the staff for a minute. I get accused of talking about the staff all the time, so I might as well just go on and do what I normally do, because I believe it. These reports have also shown the public that our teachers and our administrators and our principals are a darn good team, and they're working very, very hard for this district. Unfortunately, it's not publicized the way it should be. But what you're doing is, and that's a good thing for this district. So thank you, Mr. President. Just want to know there's some positive things coming out of this.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And, and as you know, the first meeting of the month is supposed to be dedicated to academics. So now that your committee has hit the ground running, so to speak, there's no problem providing those written reports on a monthly basis. Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
One comment. I think that I'd like to commend you on the process, which is so important. I think that process accomplishes, you know, we have a good process, you can accomplish a lot. And I think that there's a learning experience here for other areas in the district that you know, where we focus on process and put the right people in charge, we can accomplish a lot.
Thank you, Mrs. Clark. I know you want to stay, but
I have to go and make cookies.
Well, I have to go and make cookies. Anything else, Mr. Zarin?
Yes. First, I'd like to introduce Mrs. Karen Yeagans, our interim business administrator, so everyone could put the face with the name. And we welcome her and wish her the best of luck. And it is not an easy job, and certainly the news coming out of Trenton certainly indicates that it is going to be more difficult putting a budget kit together this year. But I'm very favorably impressed on our early conversations and beginning to work on this budget, and that it's looking very promising. So welcome. Thank you. I'll give a brief review. Since our last board meeting on December 7th, a few things have happened. As everyone knows, all of our elementary schools had their holiday concerts, as well as the middle school, high school, and the tree lighting ceremony, and we're very proud of our musical program, as we are with all of our programs. I received a letter today that on January 11th through the 13th, the Department of Ed Office of Special Education Programs will conduct an on-site verification visit to the district. What they do is they come in and make sure that we're doing everything we say we're doing. As mentioned, we are involved in a complete top-to-bottom curriculum revision. You've heard from Mrs. Clerico, and I would also like to thank Mrs. Francioso, who started laying the groundwork and doing all the preparation in July and August for this endeavor. But certainly, she has a hand in this, and Mrs. Clerico and Mr. Clitcher have run with this, so I thank all the women. Fall athletic season was very successful. This weekend, the winter athletic season began. As I mentioned, we're working on the 2010-11 budget. Last week, Mrs. Yeagans and myself attended a meeting with the county superintendent and county business administrator regarding district efficiencies. They go over our entire budget, and they will report back to us on where we can be more efficient. On the 9th, I had an NJSIA meeting, and the middle school concert took place. On the 10th, Mrs. Francioso also headed up a principal's meeting here, and the high school concert that evening. On the 11th, I had a meeting in Trenton, and as I said, the news coming out of Trenton, while there are a great many unknowns with the change in leadership at the governor's office, and all indications are there will be a new commissioner of education, and perhaps different philosophies, we won't know until sometime in March. Also on that day, the 11th, Friday, H1N1 inoculations were given to high school and middle school students during the day, and in the evening, the elementary students and anybody who fell into that age group were given. We had two very important committee meetings. On the 17th, we had the budget committee and the facilities committee, both very crucial as we build the budget and we start working on the final phase of facilities, very crucial. I'd also like to acknowledge Bill Nicoletti, who's standing in the corner supervising buildings and grounds, in contact with him all weekend regarding snow removal, and the wonderful job that he and his staff do to make sure that we're ready to open this morning. Thank you. Thank you very much. That's my report.
Thank you, Mr. Zarin. Board Secretary reported. Okay, moving right along. This portion of our meeting we dedicate to hearing the citizens on resolution items only. Anyone wish to be heard on resolution items only?
Either committee reports.
Oh, I apologize. Any committee reports?
I have mine, Mr. President.
Yes.
A couple of items. In July, I believe it was July, we had restructured the maintenance and facilities department. And I got a preliminary report regarding something very important to all of us, and that's cost savings. In the purchasing of maintenance supplies, material, et cetera, to maintain our buildings, we have a preliminary report of a cost savings since July of about $16,000. Pretty significant piece of change. But more significant is the cost of overtime. It looks like we've had more than half the cost savings as compared to last year in overtime and maintenance. So I'm going to have the exact figures to give to the full board next month, but I wanted to give you an idea of some direction we're going in as a district to save money and to cut costs. The policy committee is going to be meeting, I don't have a firm date in January, but certainly it will be after our, I believe, our January meeting, and I'll get that to you as soon as I could. That's it for my committee report.
Thank you. Any other committee reports?
Do a quick facilities and construction committee report, starting with Washington School. Window replacement continues off hours and will be completed by Friday, December 18th, except for 8 windows, which are being fabricated at this time. The complete window replacement is scheduled for completion by December 30th. Masonry restoration punch list was generated, and the contractor will be mobilizing to perform the punch list work off hours. Roof replacement is substantially complete, and the final inspection and walkthrough is being scheduled at this time. Yanacaw School, there's no work being done at this time. Lincoln School, the window replacement contractor is scheduled to mobilize this week. The windows were delivered last week to that facility. Window replacement work is scheduled to commence immediately following the completion of Washington School and should be done by the end of January, hopefully. Ratcliffe Elementary School, there are 5 windows remaining to be replaced. Were delivered last week and should be completed by the end of this month as well. Nutley High School new roof is scheduled for spring 2010. And spring garden addition and renovation, gymnasium exterior brick installation continues. Exterior stair footings were poured in the middle of December. Asphalt paving base course installation has been completed. HVAC, new boiler room work continues, and new boilers are installed and continuing that work. The new stair tower outside the gymnasium, the roofing has been installed for that tower. Structural steel stairs and landings were installed last week, and that work continues. Electrical rough-in with masonry installation continues, and the electrical in the existing gymnasium continues. That's all I have, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Riley. Well, one second. I have a question for you as chairman of the committee. Have we had any issues with heat at Washington and Lincoln School this winter?
We have not had any issues with heat, thanks to the backup plan that was implemented a few months ago with the electric units. The only issue that's actually transpired at Washington School was when the we had the vandalism there outside the geothermal boiler unit, and that shut down the geothermal system for a couple of hours, and we implemented the backup electrical system, which yielded zero interruption in heat.
So the system worked? The backup system worked the way it was supposed to? Good.
Thank goodness it was there.
Excellent. Mr. Riley, I'm sure that your leadership had something to do with that.
Can I just follow up on that just quickly? The geothermal, how's it doing on itself?
The geothermal on itself, let me back up, because that's a two-part question, right? Because about 6 months ago, the geothermal system was not operational at all. Since then, as I reported at the last board meeting that I attended, the plumbing contractor has been to both Washington and Lincoln multiple times as we continue to try to square that situation away. I believe that at Lincoln School there's been no problem with the geothermal system working, being operational, regardless of the temperature. We have experienced shutdown at Washington School when it went below 50 degrees. Now the interesting thing about the system is that there's actually three systems now. There's a geothermal system, there's a backup boiler system which was installed simultaneously with the geothermal system in case the geothermal ever went down. And then there's the third component, which is the electrical units, which we installed in September. So between the three systems, there's been no interruption. We're still trying to make Washington operational regardless of the temperature outside, and we continue to work on that. We're hopeful that soon we'll be in the same situation as we are at Lincoln with zero interruption. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you. One more thing on construction, because I see Radcliffe School here. We have still been looking at the windows as installed in the classrooms and trying to come up with a solution to have more ventilation and maybe change the configuration that where they open. So we haven't forgot about you. Mr. Nicoletti's working a solution with our window vendor. We will have a solution.
Yeah, just to follow up on that, Mr. President, we've discussed a few different options. The good news is something is going to change there as far as the window alignment, especially on the first floor where it's the largest problem as we see it. But we will be meeting in the next couple of weeks with the window contractor, and then we'll finalize our direction.
Thank you,
Mr. President. As Mr. Zager stated, the Budget and Finance Committee met on December 17th, and we covered three items. First is the audit report and the recommendations. Mrs. Yangman gave us a report on where we stand on each of the items, and we're making progress on all of them. One's been closed out, and then we're on track to comply with the audit recommendations by the end of this fiscal year, and so we'll have a clean audit no repeat items on the next audit. She's working with the auditors on that task. We talked about the 2009-2010 budget year. And although there are some unexpected expenses, we have some unexpected pluses and minuses in there, and we are confident that we will come in at budget and have an issue at this point in time. Finally, we worked on the 2010-2011 budget, and our goal is to construct the budget assuming zero change in state aid, and then have contingencies where state aid is cut back or other things happen. So we're going to meet again on January 21st to continue that discussion. Thank you.
Any other committee reports?
Yes. Steve, you said that we saved $16,000 on utilities and overtime. How did that happen?
Well, a couple of ways. One is the guys in the maintenance department actually were able to schedule themselves to do work which would probably be, which would cost us overtime in the past, okay? In other words, they did what had to be done on a working tour instead of coming in on a Saturday, let's say, as an example. The other thing that they did, they started to look at competitive pricing. For example, we got some examples at our meeting where, let's say, a piece of equipment would cost $500. Well, they went on the internet and found it. They get it for $250, then maybe $400. So it took a lot of that initiative on their own, but they came up with that savings. And I think it's a little bit more than what I gave you. That's kind of conservative. But it shows, though, that they're out there and they're working hard to help us as a district to reduce costs.
So in other words, we can kind of look forward to continual savings in these areas.
Oh, I'm absolutely sure you will.
Good. To be the wrench or whatever, when we constructed the current fiscal year budget, we did cut their overtime significantly and their budget significantly. So some of these things are necessary in order to hit budget this year. It's great, but they have to make the effort. And again, it's process and teamwork and getting the job done.
Point well taken, Mr.
Any other comments before we... I'll ask you later, Mr. Bush. Now, once again, hearing the citizens on resolution items, and anyone who wishes to be heard on resolution items. Seeing no one, why don't you close that portion of the meeting? Mr. Cook, would you move superintendent resolutions 1 through 14? 16.
Yes, Mr. President. I move Superintendent Resolutions 1 through 14 as distributed.
Second. Second by Mr. Scarpelli. Any discussion?
Yes, I have one question.
Yes.
Mr. Zara?
Yes.
The high school testing coordinator, Mr. Williams, could you please share with us what that is?
Yes, as we all know in education, that we become compelled to devote more and more time to standardized testing. And we have always had, and we will continue to need, a testing coordinator that actually coordinates as a liaison between the school district and the State Department of Education, deals with security issues with testing, deals with any anomalies, deals with test scores, test score analysis. It's very crucial. And as Mr. Williams assumes, and by the way, this is retroactive to the beginning of the year, and as Mr. Williams assumes more duties as the acting vice principal, these responsibilities will be passed along to somebody else. But it's something that's definitely needed, but very good question. People don't understand, for the most part, what he does, or anybody in that role.
Thank you.
I see here that we have teaching extra classes, $12,000, and I'm not questioning the amount, but I'm just curious as to why and how that happened.
We're talking about number 8,
yes.
Teach extra class. That's based on the individual's step on the guide.
Oh, no, I'm not saying that. I'm saying why do we need that?
Because we needed, the way the schedule broke down, we needed one uncovered class covered.
All right.
So the department chairman took that on, as you say.
You couldn't get, in other words, you couldn't get a part-timer for one class?
No. Okay. No. Right. Perhaps 3, but not 1.
Yeah, sure. All right.
Any other questions, Mr. Regan? Okay. Mr. Kuzin, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Giannacola.
Yes.
Mr. Kuzin.
Yes.
Mr. Mascarotola.
Yes.
Mr. Riley.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
Mrs. Russo.
Yes.
Mrs. Slaughter.
Yes.
Dr. Cassell.
Yes. Mr. Francole, would you please read Superintendent Resolution Number 15 testimonial?
Yes, Mr. President. Testimony of Vice Principal, Mrs. Ann L. Starris. Whereas Mrs. Ann L. Starris attended her resignation as high school vice principal effective January 1, 2010. And has signified her intention of retiring from active service. And whereas Mrs. Starris has served as an elementary teacher, guidance counselor, director of guidance, and as vice principal in the Nutley Public Schools for a period of 40 years. And whereas through the years, Mrs. Starris has exemplified the finest qualities of her profession at all times. Now therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education expresses Mrs. Starris' a deep appreciation of her long and faithful service and extends to her its best wishes for continued health and happiness. And be it further resolved that this resolution be made part of the minutes of this meeting and a copy presented to Mrs. Starris. I so move.
Second. Second, Mr. Cook.
Mr. Francole.
Before I say yes, of course, I would like to say thanks to Mrs. Sarris for a job well done. As I was the director of athletics, I've worked with her as the vice principal of the school, and she was always there, always helpful to the athletic program, students. Anytime I had a question regarding to eligibility, we went down to see her, and she helped me tremendously. I only wish her the best. She's a wonderful person. Yes.
Mr. Kutcher.
Yes.
Mr. Mascarotola.
Yes.
Mr. Riley.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
Mrs. Russo.
Yes.
Mr. Sordo.
Yes.
Dr. Cassell.
Yes, and I'd like to echo Mr. Francole's sentiments. Mr. Sorter, would you please read Superintendent Resolution Number 16 testimonial?
Yes, testimonial teacher, Mrs. Maria K. Khan, Maria. Whereas Mrs. Maria Khan has tendered her resignation as learning disability teacher consultant effective January 1, 2010, has signified her intention of retiring from active service. Whereas Ms. Khan has served as an elementary teacher and as learning disability teacher consultant in Nutley Public Schools for a period of 35 years. And whereas Through the years, Ms. Khan has exemplified the finest qualities of the teaching profession at all times. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education expresses to Ms. Khan its deepest appreciation for her long and faithful service and extends to her its best wishes for continued health and happiness. And it therefore be resolved that this resolution be made part of the minutes of this meeting and a copy presented to Ms. Khan. So moved.
Second.
Second.
Second, Mr. Cookman. Roll call, please.
Mr. Francola.
Yes.
Mr. Cookman.
Yes.
Mr. Mascarotola.
Yes.
Mr. Riley.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
Mrs. Russo.
Yes.
Mr. Soto.
Yes.
Dr. Passau.
Yes. Mr. Rogers, would you read resolution number 17, testimonial, please?
Yes, testimonial for Mr. William L. Farkas. Whereas Mr. William L. Farkas has tendered his resignation as cooperative industrial education teacher effective December 1st, 2009, and has signified his intention of retiring from active service. And whereas Mr. Farkas has served as a physical ed teacher and as a cooperative industrial education teacher in the Nutley Public Schools for a period of 40 years. Whereas through the years, Mr. Farkas has exemplified the finest qualities of the teaching profession at all times. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of Education expresses to Mr. Farkas its deep appreciation for his long and faithful service and extends to him its best wishes for continued health and happiness. And be it further resolved that this resolution be made part of the minutes of this meeting and a copy presented to Mr. Farkas. So moved.
Second.
Second.
Second, Mrs. Russo. Yes,
sir. Yes, I know Mr. Farkas. I worked with him for many years, and I think he worked for several years prior to coming to Nutley, so he had a long tenure in education. And I'd also like to make note that he was a football coach, and I think he was a coach for about 5 years, and he had pretty successful seasons. And I don't know a whole lot about football, to be honest with you, but several people have told me that do know football that he was like an excellent defensive coach. So I wish him well.
Any other comment? Yeah, I would like to echo that. Mr. Farkas was a football coach when I was in Nutley High School back in 1964. I'd just like to say for the record, I finally believe you that you didn't empty my locker. We used to have a little debate about that. Roll the roll, please.
Mr. Francola.
Yes.
Mr. Cookman.
Yes.
Mr. Mascarotola.
Yes.
Mr. Riley.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
Mrs. Russo.
Yes.
Mrs. Soto.
Yes.
Dr. Passau.
Yes. Okay. Mr. Mascarotola, would you move Board Secretary Resolutions 1 through 25, please?
I'd like to move Secretary Business Administrator and Board Secretary Resolutions 1 through 25 as so listed.
Second.
Second.
Second, Mr. Riley. Any discussion?
Yes. Let's turn to page 18 of the bill, mandatory bill for debate. Let's start with that. Page 18 to 27. Mr. Soto, I'm going to need your help to refresh my memory about something.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
That's a problem.
Media consultants, $14,388 broadcast studio equipment at Nutley High School.
Yeah.
What would this be?
That would be our TV studio.
TV channel 77, right? Okay, here comes my memory, Mr. Soder.
Yes.
Did we not have a meeting with the township?
Yes, we did. I remember that.
Were we led to believe, or I'll just say I was led to believe, and if I'm wrong, please correct me.
That's right.
That there would be some relief, either funding or equipment, to Nutley High School from the cable companies or the panel, somebody?
Yes. Okay. I recall that, yes.
All right.
Now, the exact details I don't, but I know there was talk of reimbursement for some of that. Yes.
Okay. Mr. President, what I'm driving at is this. If we could have our administration follow up on the meeting that Mr. Soder and I had at the township, or if you would like us to, I'll certainly do that. But there was some discussion about funding or equipment or getting something to this district that would help this $14,000 price tag.
Yeah, I think that if you meet with Mr. Zara, Mrs. Yen, Executive Committee, we memorialize the day. I'm sure we get a correspondence off and documented and wait for a reply.
All right, thank you. All right, number two. Let's go to page 22 of 27. Everybody has a pet peeve, and I have one. Probably will get me nowhere, although it did get me somewhere, Mrs. Zarek.
What page is that you're referencing again?
I'm sorry, page 22 of 27. This is the mandatory bill payments.
Do you have the list out there, Mrs. Confusion?
I don't recall, but those pages are the mandatory as 27. 3 of 8, 5 of 8, 7 of 8.
Excuse me. We have on the table several copies. It's not just one copy, so if you want to take time before he goes to the board and get it, it's there. They're all posted. It may appear as though there's only one copy of documents, but there are several copies there. What's that?
Appendix C.
It says Appendix C. You have them out there?
I'm sorry, Appendix what?
C.
This goes to page 8. Here we go, though. I apologize. I have it here. Let's go through 1 of 8.
Wait, you don't have Appendix C?
Appendix C.
Jack, Jerry will help you. Jerry will help you on that. I got the same thing.
Same thing.
It just goes to page 8.
It just goes to page 8.
Where are the rest of the pages? Page 8. It's not Appendix C.
Kenny. Thanks, Cass.
Appendix C doesn't have the
account numbers. All right, I'm referring to the R.J. Cody Marine, page number 22-27, right there.
It would be page 6 of 8 in the handout that you have.
All right, I have page 22-27.
Page 6.
Cody Arena?
Yep, that's one. All set?
Cross-referencing what you're saying, it's R6 of 8?
Yes.
6 of 8?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. You all set now?
I guess.
Okay, thanks. Okay, one of the things I'm curious about is this, and I know we have to pay the county X amount of dollars, but there's a bill here for the R.J. Cody Arena for $9,418.75. And I suppose that's for ice hockey.
Yes.
Ice time, $3,506.25. Another bill, oh, I see, that's a total, $5,912.50. Here's my point, and this is there. We had talked about this regarding the use of the county softball field, I believe, sometimes, or you were able to assist us with that.
Yes.
My contention is this, that we pay enough county taxes to enable this township to receive, I believe, some relief from the county with regard to some of our sports programs. So I would request that, as you did with the baseball, softball field, Mrs. Zarek, that we get a letter off to the county superintendent, county executive, and request that the county kind of think about that, giving us some sort of relief as a school district with regard to these payments for these sports programs. We certainly pay a good amount of tax dollars to the county, and I think we should get something in return. Okay, that's all I have to say about that. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments on the Board Secretary of Business Administrator resolutions?
Mr. Frangola.
Yes.
Yes, to all, but bills and mandatory payments, check number 081892 and check standing.
Yes.
Mr. Riley.
Yes.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes, to all but communication bills.
Mrs. Russo.
Yes, to all but number 23. I abstain specifically to the Telefonte Nero.
Mr. Sawyer.
Yes.
Dr. Cassell.
Yes. At this portion of the meeting, we have a hearing of citizens on any school matter whatsoever. We ask that the comments be limited to 3 minutes, and we wait until everyone's had an opportunity to speak until you come to the mic and ask a second question. I just ask that you just clearly state your name and address and direct all comments or questions through the chair. Seeing none, we close this portion of the meeting. Any old business? Old business, new business.
Well, I have new business. Mr. President, may I?
Absolutely.
Okay, first, I'd like to introduce the principal of the Radcliffe School, our board rep there, Mr. Mike Carney. Mr. Carney, I always take this opportunity, always will wherever I am in public, to commend the staff. I want to commend you for a job well done at the musical. It was a great program you put together with your staff. See, we have PTO members and teachers here. I also want to let you know it's a pleasure working with you at Radcliffe School. In fact, it's an honor to see the work they do and, you know, the commitment they have. I deeply appreciate that. I wanted to take this time to publicly recognize you for that because you're here, and I thank you. Secondly, with regard to the communications situation regarding internet and interconnectivity with the township, etc., I spoke with Mr. Tucci. Remember we were talking about that? And we're planning a meeting in January with Ian, by the way, who's sitting over there, who's a real top-notch guy when it comes to these things, and the township internet guru, if you will. And it looks like that if we go down a road that these guys can pull together, we might be saving significant money in the near future. So that's still ongoing. And then the $64 million question, the website. Where are we with the website?
Mr. Cook, would you like to?
Mr. Wright, we, during the closed session, we talked about it for a fair amount of length of time, and I think the resolve is that we're going to get a smaller group together, move this thing forward. I'll fill you in.
Okay. If Mr. Cook, if we go down that road, I would hope that we include those hardworking citizens that
yes.
work very hard, long hours to pull this together.
Yeah, just something else. Yes. Okay. Just to bring you up to speed and everyone else. We had an in-house RFP, and talking about the volunteer committee, which worked hard on that website, the presentation that was given in the auditorium back in June by the website committee was actually Ian helped put that together. So that's basically the package we're looking at. And we're going to meet and make recommendations to the board based on cost, whether we need a full-time dedicated person, et cetera, and so forth, and we will definitely keep you in the loop with that.
And finally, Mr. Cook, I have a question for you, and you're not a French. You've got good questions. I respect you for your hand, believe me. When you go through the budget process, I wonder if you can do this. Can you call in, like, some of the staff, the maintenance guys, the grounds guys, can you call in the workers? You know, I've learned a long time ago that we get some of the greatest ideas from the troops out there on the field, and they can bring to the budget committee, I believe. When I say they, this is inclusive of everyone who works in this district, they may bring some great cost-saving ideas to the budget committee. So if you could think about that, I'd appreciate it.
Yes, as acting business administrator says, that should be an ongoing process. And we've talked about that, actually, in one of our budget finance committee meetings about, you know, looking at functional costs and how the most efficient ones in those areas. And I agree that we have to bring in the ones who actually do the work to be part of the process.
Thank you very much.
Yes, well, can I go back in history here for a minute? I just want to take a little closer look at this.
You want some latitude?
Yes, true.
So we give latitude.
Some longitude and latitude.
Use the latitude.
Okay.
And longitude.
How much money do you think each one of these people saved us by dropping out of our health plan, so to speak?
If it was a family plan, traditional, the cost is probably in excess of $20,000.
It's. I think we can be more precise in the answer in that the payment is 25% of the difference in the premium costs. So for every dollar that we paid out, there's $3 reduction in premiums.
Now, that's on the new contract, correct?
Yes.
Right.
That's
I don't know if those project. I don't know if those numbers are based on the new contract or people who opted out as of July 1.
This would be the payment.
Well, still pretty good because
one of the things we negotiated.
It looks like we saved $120,000 here, right?
I would say.
Very good.
On one page of names, correct?
Excellent. as a good contractor for this year. Very good.
Anyone else, anything else on the new business? Seeing none, I...
I'll get to adjourn.
On behalf...
Oh, Christmas came early.
Of the Board of Education, I wish everyone a very healthy and happy New Year, happy holidays, Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, and I'd like to entertain that motion.
Second.
Second, Mr. Riley.